With Todd Black, legend Kirk Herbstreit, I'm Scott Van Pelt. Most coveted piece of hardware for an individual in college football, obviously, boys, is the Heisman. And last year, this time of year, we'd have been talking about Trent Richardson, Andrew Luck, maybe Landry Jones at Oklahoma. Robert Griffin III was in that good player, but not a favorite, and he ended up winning it. So if we're looking at a dark horse name right now that could go to New York and take home the Heisman, Todd, give me a name you like.
I like Tyler Wilson, quarterback at Arkansas. You know, it's going to be important that Arkansas wins one of those big home games against either Alabama or LSU, but I think he's the best quarterback in the SEC. Very talented guy. Gets Niall Davis back to take some of the load of that offense, running the football, but I like Tyler Wilson.
It'd be interesting to see how not having Bobby Petrino there to call the plays could have a potential negative impact, not on just him, but that whole offense. I think Tavon Austin, wide receiver at West Virginia, has a chance to put up monster numbers in the Big 12. You're going to see him as a punt returner, kick returner, runs the ball at times, and of course lines up out at wide receiver. Last year averaged 15 yards per touch. Every time he touched the ball, he's getting 15 yards. If he does that again and they have the kind of year I think they'll have, he could be in the mix.
And because he'd be doing it in the Big 12 as opposed to the Big East, you're not going to face the way the Big East is framed nationally as a conference. All right, Herbie, you just went non-quarterback. So is there another name besides Tavon Austin that's not a quarterback?
Well, there's some good running backs out there. I mean, you mentioned Niall Davis. Marcus Lattimore is coming back, appears to be healthy and on track. I'm going to go back to Monte Ball. Obviously, he had the mishap away from the field where he got jumped by some people, but looks like he's going to be okay if he's healthy. And if Danny O'Brien takes some of the pressure off of that running game, I think Monte Ball could have a huge year.
Todd, a non-quarterback that you've got your eye on potentially for the Heisman.
Well, I still think Oregon, even though they lose their quarterback, Darren Thomas, is still going to be such an explosive offense. I like Kenyon Barner. I know he's going to have to share touches with DeAnthony Thomas, but I think Barner, if he stays healthy, is going to have a monster season.
Thomas is the kind of guy that could become a Heisman candidate. If Barner, you know, happens to him, he dings up an ankle, and then Thomas starts getting the ball, he could become a Heisman favorite by the time we reach, say, Halloween. All right. December, New York City, the Heisman, it's a big deal. You get to be there, Herbie. Who do you think wins it?
I think there's a lot of pressure on this guy and when he decided to come back, but I think Matt Barkley made a decision for the right reasons, and I think he's going to face a ton of outside pressure. Did he make the right decision if he has a bad game? And people comparing his numbers to Andrew Luck. A lot of bad outside influences on him, but he seems to be a guy that can handle that, and if he does with the receivers that he has, can you imagine the numbers? Yeah. It's going to be like a video game this year.
Well, I agree. I think that's who will win it, and that's the same reason I would say the two guys he's throwing to on the outside are first-round draft picks.
Absolutely.
I mean, he's going to have incredible numbers if he stays healthy. I think it's Matt Barkley.
If you look at the men who were in New York City last year, it was Griffin, Luck, Richardson, all go in the top five. Tyrann Mathieu ran into the situation at LSU, so he's not in the game. So the one man that has a chance to make it back to New York City, one of the men, Herbie mentioned Monte Ball, but both these guys like Matt Barkley, another Heisman for USC.
Chances that a team beyond LSU or Bama wins the SEC?
How about zero?
SEC coach that will not have his job come December.
Joker Phillips.
SEC fans, best behaved, worst behaved.
Vanderbilt, best behaved, worst behaved, probably Florida.
Most irrational fans in the SEC.
That would be my alma mater, the University of Tennessee.
Better first year in the league, Texas A&M or Missouri?
No brainer, Missouri.
Vanderbilt, Paul Feinbaum, are you buying the hype on Vanderbilt or are they still just Vandy?
Same old Vandy.
One from your backyard now, Nick Saban. Three national titles already. He will finish his career with how many national titles?
That will be five, one short of Bear Bryant.
At the end of the year, the guy who will be thought of as the better quarterback, Arkansas's Tyler Wilson or Georgia's Aaron Murray?
Tyler Wilson.
LSU and Bama, they're both at Arkansas this year. Will Arkansas win at least one of those games?
Not a chance.
Not a chance.
Not
that Arkansas
a chance. Not with John L. Smith.
You don't like John L. Smith?
Not crazy.
What is it about John L. Smith you don't like?
Well, Petrino would have probably beaten LSU, but I don't think John L. can do either one.
You don't trust him. Major upset, the SEC team that will surprise people, Paul.
That will be second week, Missouri beats Georgia.
SEC, currently 10 of the top 10 teams, they have five in the AP poll. Do you see them still having five at the end of the season?
No, no way.
Who wins the SEC 2012?
Until 2 weeks ago, I liked LSU. Honey Badger out. Alabama wins the SEC.
Mr. Feinbaum, is it crazier than ever, your job being the mouth of the South?
It is.
You enjoy it, though.
I do. I really do, Joe.
Well, we've enjoyed having you here on College Football Live. Your first visit in person.
first to Bristol.
Let's recap the offseason. It was a busy offseason, a lot of off-field incidents dominating the college football headlines over in Fayetteville, Arkansas. Bobby Petrino let go as the head coach for the Razorbacks after an incident where he crashed his motorcycle. He was found with...
The Razorbacks had momentum, gaining ground on SEC West heavyweights.
Boy, Houdini's in the house. Wearing number three. Touchdown, Holy Hog!
After an offseason filled with turmoil, a head coach dismissed, the program stands at a crossroad. Can the Hogs weather the storm? The time to dig deep is now on the road to the BCS Championship.
The outlook was quite promising for Arkansas late last season. At one point, they were number three in the BCS standings behind LSU and Alabama. How quickly things changed. Bobby Petrino let go this offseason. Enter John L. Smith. This is a team that still has some talent coming back. High expectations from a year ago. But with a new head coach, and you take away Petrino, who was also the play caller, Luke's, and one of the best play callers in college football, how do we now color our outlook for Arkansas?
Well, I think with John L. Smith, you've got a coach that's had a tremendous amount of success at many destinations. So they've got a wealth of experience with him. He's familiar with the roster. He's familiar with the players, having coached there as an assistant. Naturally, I think Bobby Petrino, nobody discounts the fact he's one of the premier play callers, getting his team in the right position to make plays. But I think personnel, more than anything else, is the biggest issue with this team. No Jarius Wright, no Joe Adams, no Greg Childs. You've got Kobe Hamilton back, but you don't have a wealth of playmakers around them at the skill spots that they've become accustomed to having the last couple of years. I think Niall Davis is maybe the best, most complete back, including Marcus Lattimore, in the conference. But until this football team proves that up front they can handle the likes of a Florida or a Alabama or an LSU, then they're I think, going to be exactly what they've been the last 2 to 3 years. So regardless of who the coach is, regardless of the distractions, what it comes down to is, do they have proven commodities out wide on offense? And in their defensive front seven, can they hold up with the elite of the conference?
But they have Tyler Wilson and Niall Davis.
Yes.
And I think John L. Smith was probably the best choice in retrospect to come in.
Too.
He knows the kids, and the kids are comfortable with him. And that's such a huge thing. The schemes are the same. They will not take a drop off. Paul Petrino, he has to prove he's as good a play caller as his brother. Maybe that's
sure.
The case.
And he did a nice job in Illinois.
No, he did.
Yeah.
And it's different offense a little bit. But the reality is, I think they're in really good shape. And I think they'll make some noise. I think they're going to beat some people this year.
I think the reality is we're looking at Ohio State 2.0. So last year with Ohio State, they lost their coach. They had the interim coach, Luke Fickell. Mm-hmm. So there was this transition period, and everybody felt like it was a transition, and everybody said, yes, he has an opportunity, but nobody really thought that Ohio State was going to go with him. They wanted the latest and greatest.
Right.
Well, Arkansas is in the same position. You've got these kids. They're fighting for a coach now.
Yeah, but Arkansas has got a quarterback.
But the difference being is that nobody's committed to the coach. Nobody said this is our guy.
Yeah.
Why won't they commit? Like, is he or isn't he? So you're in this transition period. It's very difficult to get a group of guys to rally and run through a wall for a guy in a transition period.
You know, I like the coach. I like Niall Davis. I really like Tyler Wilson.
Me too.
I think he's one of the toughest quarterbacks in the conference.
I think we all agree on
but
that.
But you know what? The thing that I really question about them is them in the trenches.
Yeah.
I mean, up front, Tyler Wilson got hit an awful lot. I think Niall Davis being in there will take the pressure off of him to have to make those plays downfield. But he doesn't have Joe Adams. He doesn't have Jarius Wright. He doesn't have some of the skill guys to unload the ball and go downfield with. He doesn't quite have that arsenal. He doesn't have Petrino there calling the plays anymore. I question them on both sides of the ball up front.
Let's not forget, too, the value of Joe Adams in the kicking game in a similar fashion to Tyrann Mathieu at LSU in the kicking game, and the production you lose there of flipping field position.
Playmaker.
He was a playmaker, and it affects the kicking game, not just the offensive production.
I think John L. Smith, personality-wise, and the fact that he was familiar with the personnel and the schemes was the right choice. But his last couple of seasons at Michigan State did not go well.
Nope.
How does this team react when something goes wrong? Could be pretty fragile. But I'm telling you, whether you loved him or hated him, Bobby Petrino was a great play caller.
Yep.
I think that's the reason he'll have a job at a major school within 2 years.
Last word, Jason, is John L. Smith the coach of Arkansas next season?
I don't think so. I think the way college football goes now is they look for the latest and greatest and who's hot. And in January, we'll find out.
All right. I'm Southern, and even I can't make yeas have three syllables. But nevertheless, Alabama looking.
And they're all disappointed in you because of it.
Oh, yeah, no kidding. The Alabama trying to become the first team to repeat BCS national titles. What's the likelihood?
I think it's going to be. They definitely have a shot. I think it's going to be extremely difficult. But obviously, if there's one coach that can pull it off, it's Nick Saban. And everybody looks to that November 3rd matchup against LSU on the road, by the way. But for me, I'm looking at September 15th at Arkansas. Now, I know a lot of people out there are saying that because it's going to be John L. Smith coaching this team, not Bobby Petrino, that they have no shot this year. And I'm telling you, if there's one area that you have to be concerned about for Alabama, it's that secondary. It's a little bit young. But once again, I qualify that statement because we are talking about Nick Saban, and Nick Saban spends most of his time on the practice field. If he's with any unit, he's going to be with those defensive backs. So they're young, but they're going to have one of the best coaches in the country working directly with him.
Well, that defense may be young, but Alabama does have a veteran quarterback, and if he picks up right where he left off.
Great offensive line, too.
Great offensive line, anchored by some veteran leadership.
August in Fayetteville, Arkansas. After an off-season of upheaval, the opening of camp is a relief. The long, hot days of practice with temperatures soaring into the hundreds are predictable. The routine is a comfort.
All expect is all you got. It's pretty damn simple from there on out. If we think we're the best, we'll be the best. If we think we're champions, we'll be champions.
The Hogs are coming off their best season in 5 years, having finished 2011 with a number 5 ranking and a record of 11-2. Those two losses, both on the road, were to Alabama and LSU, the two contenders in last season's national championship game.
Right now, this team, you guys, we have an opportunity to be special. When the damn door opens, you better be ready to jump through it. You've got a place and time in history right now. Jump through the damn door. Let's go.
By the spring, it was clear that two of the Hogs' most potent weapons would return for 2012. First-team All-SEC quarterback Tyler Wilson chose a shot at college glory over the NFL. And running back Niall Davis had recovered from a season-ending injury suffered a year ago. Head coach Bobby Petrino had all the pieces in place to make a run at the conference crown after returning the Razorback program to prominence.
When I hired Coach Petrino, I knew the kind of coach he was, a hard-driving, tough taskmaster who had great discipline and accountability in his team. So, and I think he set out to instill those things in our team, in our student-athletes, and, you know, I think our program reflects that. And I do think you need that kind of leader in an SEC environment as tough as this conference is when it comes to football.
He's a great coach. You know, he's won anywhere he's been. He knows how to do things. And so he came in here and taught the players how to grind. They know how to work. They know how to go about their business. They know how to show up and get better every day.
He brought a sense of organization, work ethic, a tremendous amount of desire to win and what you have to do in order to win. And I think we've had all the blocks put in place in order for us to continue that.
We've just got a winning attitude now. We don't want the Cotton Bowl. We don't want the BC. We don't want the Sugar Bowl. We want championships now. You know, I think we've gotten to the point where losing is not an option.
Well, it changed under Petrino. I think, you know, people around here now believe and feel, you know, when he was running this thing that they were capable of winning the national title, and that's something that it was hard to say, I think, you know, 10 years ago. He really helped these guys feel like that they're a big-time football program.
Breaking news this noon hour, Arkansas head football coach Bobby Petrino recovering after a motorcycle accident. Arkansas State Police.
A guy that I didn't even know, he was like, did you hear about your coach? I was like, no, I didn't hear about it. He was like, it's all over Twitter, you know, he got an accident. And I was like, you know, is he okay? It was like, yeah, he's alive. You know, I didn't know what had happened, and I found out he was kind of hurt. But then the allegations started to come out, and it was like, you know, just something for someone to talk about. I didn't think it would add any truth to it.
We were returning from a retreat for the university, and I got the phone call from Coach Petrino at that time. What was said was that he had more to share with me, and that there was a passenger on the motorcycle, and that it was our employee, Jessica Durrell.
Arkansas coach Bobby Petrino
Petrino is at it again. If he's not quitting on his team in the middle of the night via letter, he's running around on his wife with a subordinate half his age, laying his Harley down in the street and then lying about it.
But it was difficult. It was strained. He was upset and he was concerned, and he was still suffering from the effects of the accident at that point as well.
It was a controversy that could have torn a team apart.
I'd say the team morale probably at that point was kind of disappointed and a little bit angry, you know. That's something that we really believed in him. And then, you know, with that happening, even though it wasn't football related, it was, you know, it's something that we pride ourselves on, is, you know, taking care of each other as family.
Well, it wasn't a sense of we felt betrayed. It was just of a sense of, like, man, ain't that happened? And then it was just, well, now what?
Well, we set forth on our administrative review, and then once we knew the facts and additional facts came out during that review, it became very clear to me that we needed to dismiss Coach and move in a different direction.
This afternoon, I have informed Coach Petrino that his employment with the university was being terminated immediately.
Well, I think it had a tremendous impact anytime you lose your leader in any kind of circumstance. You know, that's one of the things that a team, you know, of any sort, whether it be business or football team, basketball team, it makes it tough.
It was a decision made by the athletic department, which and the athletic director, Jeff Long, that he had facts that we didn't have, and he had to make that decision. So you got to go with what's best for the program and move forward.
You know, I think kind of what I said from day one. I think everybody in the world makes mistakes. He's obviously paying for it. He's trying to make everything right, move on with his life. He's my brother. I love him. I'll always be there for him. Always do everything I can. It definitely was a, you know, it hurt him. It hurt the players. It hurt us.
The night that we were all informed that he was dismissed was, it was kind of a weird atmosphere. Jeff Long walks into the team room and all the coaches are there, and it's kind of an eerie deal. And a lot of people were not sure the direction that it was going to go after that.
I know that when I left that room that day, there was an opportunity for some leaders to step forward and talk about the future, and I thought that was very impressive.
Tenarius Wright was a guy that I think came up huge that night. You know, there was kind of a sense of who's going to take it from here, who's going to take charge to step up, and Tank said something, and you need to, everybody sit down. And he said it with a loud, commanding voice. And I think that was a huge turning point. If I had to pick now, that was a big point. And then he and I both got up and spoke.
Tenarius Wright, you know, told everybody to sit down. You know, and everybody sat down. And everybody sat up. You know, and he just said that, you know, our goals haven't changed.
I kind of wanted to see everyone's face and see what everybody's emotion was. And my emotion came out. It was basically to tell the team that no matter what happens, I'm still willing to, you know, put it all on the line, and I expect the same thing from the teammates.
You know, I think when it first happened, we understood that we can either hang separately or hang together, and we've all decided, hey, we're going to hang together, and we're going to make this thing work, and we're going to be successful, and we're going to win football games and do it the right way.
You could have had a situation where a number of guys left. And I think that speaks volumes for what was said that night and how people used that situation to kind of see how it was going to go, see if the leaders, see if the coaches, see if the administration was going to waver. And nobody did. Everybody stood strong. And I think that spoke volumes and said, hey, we're staying put. This is a pretty good place to be.
2 weeks ago today, we set out on a search to find a new head coach for the University of Arkansas.
Well, it began almost immediately, and then it first began with our own staff looking at our assistant head coach and our two coordinators. But once looking at that situation, none of those individuals had any head coaching experience. And then I began to look outside, look at other coaches who had expressed interest. But it wasn't until an assistant coach through one of my staff members shared that Coach Smith would be interested in helping if he could. And at that point, I was within my process of looking at coaches, and he was someone that I immediately thought, I need to take a look at him.
At this time, it's my honor and my pleasure to formally introduce head football coach of the Arkansas Razorbacks, John L. Smith.
For 40 years, John L. Smith has walked the sidelines of college football. He's held head coaching positions at six different schools, including Louisville and Michigan State, and has earned the reputation as a rebuilder of programs. Smith has also mentored many other coaches along the way, including Bobby Petrino. From 2009 to 2011, Smith served as Petrino's special teams coordinator and outside linebackers coach at Arkansas.
They were poised for an incredible year. And as I looked at it, I thought, what would give them the best opportunity to be successful this season? And then as I examined John L. Smith, he had worked, I think, with eight of the nine coaches on his staff. He knew the student athletes on this team. He knew the mindset of this team. He was a mentor to Coach Petrino, so he understood that whole mindset and that approach to the game of football. It made all the sense in the world, and I think that Coach John L. Smith was the perfect choice for the circumstances we had.
Our expectations are that we're going to go ahead and we're going to battle, and we're going to fight for a national title.
Coach Smith was the perfect fit in terms of he's had head coaching experience. He's been in this program for 3 years. And as players, you need a little bit of that, especially during these times. You know, and I'm excited about having Coach Smith as our head coach.
Now, go attack him with your head across the bow. Let me see your eyes. Get your eyes up. That's a little bit better.
Once Coach Smith came in, and then they let us know it was going to be same coaching staff, it was, you know, it was a breath of fresh air. Everybody was, it was focused on them.
I was happy because I thought it was a good decision to bring somebody that was familiar with the program, familiar with the state, familiar with us back in, just to kind of keep everything under control and everything is close to, you know, the same.
Well, I think as I took a look at it coming in, you know, I thought we're facing adversity, and these guys, particularly this football team and this coaching staff, they don't want to see the boat being rocked and coming in. I think that maybe I can provide a little stability as far as and making sure that we're not going to change things. We're going to keep things along the same path that we've been going and just continue on.
With only a 10-month contract, Smith faces the unusual task of overseeing a program he might not be coaching come December.
All right, let's go.
I don't know if I've ever seen anything like this before. You know, you've seen the interim coach for a season tag. I don't know if you've seen a 10-month contract. You know, it's really weird writing that, you know, John L. Smith was signed to a 10-month contract, because you want to write 10-year contracts. That's what you're used to writing.
Hey, 25! Get out underneath him!
I think bringing back John L. was a great move because, you know, really John L., that's who, you know, outside of my dad, John L.'s who brought up both my brother and me in this profession. You know, we both started out coaching for him. We both coached for him for a long time. So him coming back as the head coach, all the base philosophies and everything, just the way we go about doing things every day doesn't change.
That's it. Come off. Let's go. There we go.
Well, not that bad. Come on.
Like when both Petrinos were on his staff at Louisville, the philosophy remains consistent, but Smith's personality is different.
One over here and one over here will go.
Coach Smith being the head of our team right now, it's probably a more relaxed team, you know, although we used to grind with us being an older class team, you know, just a lot of redshirt juniors and redshirt seniors here, fifth-year guys. We just owe the team, and I think it's more relaxed and the team's just more mature.
Good job yesterday, Coach Smith.
Good job, Coach. Coach Johnson, go have a great day. First day.
I think our kids are probably having a little bit more fun. I mean, Coach Smith's personality is such that he wants to work and he wants to grind, obviously, and that's the foundation of the program that Coach Petrino set up. But at the same time, I think there's a fine line about, hey, let's go have fun still. Let's enjoy practice. Let's enjoy each other maybe more.
Why do you think that happened? Because you got, well, yeah, and you got long, and you never got your second step down. So you're on one foot, so you're going to get knocked on your butt. As we win as a team, that's what this game's all about. That's what makes it worthwhile to everybody on the team. So it's not throwing for so many thousand yards. It's a matter of us winning as a football team that makes this whole thing important and worthwhile. There you go!
Coming up on College Football Confidential, Arkansas.
Outside of here, you know, just thought everything was crumbling and falling down, but really in here, we knew we were going to show up and go to work the same way we have every other day and keep doing things the way we've done them and just move on and keep getting better.
All our grades done by Friday? You did a good job yesterday. Made some plays. Starting to find a home. Starting to be a better player. We need to get those grades done.
One of the more curious situations in the wake of Bobby Petrino's firing is that his brother Paul remains with the team. Hired as the offensive coordinator after last season, the younger Petrino also coaches the quarterbacks.
But what Tyler did a great job up here, everyone. He threw it to the shoulder away from the nearest defender.
Paul has handled this situation incredibly well. I have great respect for him and the way he's managed this. And he's a football coach, and he is coaching these young men extremely hard in a positive way. So Paul has done nothing but impress me throughout this process.
I think he handled it very well. He came out and he spoke not long after the decision or whatever happened. It had to have been very, very tough to be going through that. And it was really impressive hearing him kind of just powering through this. But you know, I think that's the way the Petrino family works. You know, obviously you love your brothers and your family and stuff, but you also know that you've got a job. And I think he's handled it that way. He knows he's got a job to do. He's going out there and doing it.
Can't get jammed! You can't get jammed, Kobe!
You know, it was difficult, but you know, I think the coaching staff respects me. They know I work hard. They know I go about my business every day and do everything I can. And there's no question the players do, and me and Tyler have a great relationship. And to be honest, I think it made us all come even closer.
If you don't throw it to them, they're not going to do it in the game. We cover something to me, throw it to them, so he'll do it in the game.
Outside of here, you know, just thought everything was crumbling and falling down, but really in here, we knew we were going to show up and go to work the same way we have every other day and keep doing things the way we've done them and just move on and keep getting better.
Hey, that's not working hard, 71. That's not trying to get better right there. That's going through the motions. All right.
One key piece to Petrino's offense is Tyler Wilson, the only Razorback quarterback to ever be named first team All-SEC. An Arkansas native and lifelong Hogs fan, Wilson's decision to return for his senior year comes as no surprise.
I didn't feel ready to go. You know, there's something deep down inside that says, hey, I've got some unfinished business. I'm an Arkansas guy, I've lived here my whole life. This is comfort to me. I have a relationship with a lot of the guys in the locker room. I felt like I wanted to be in college. Why not stay? Why not, you know, accomplish something that hadn't been accomplished here?
Coming back, I think that's a personal thing to him, that he wanted to prove something. You know, maybe try to do something that nobody else has done in a long time around here. So I think that's a personal thing with him. And it's great to have him back, of course. And I think the team loves having him here. So we certainly love him.
Tyler's like offensive general. You know, he's just sitting back there masterminding plays, masterminding designs for them to come out and attack the defense. And with Tyler and his enthusiasm, the way he thinks he has so much more to accomplish. And that's what's really making Tyler just a dynamic player that he really is.
Put it right on. That's the way to throw the ball.
It was crucial for Tyler to come back because, you know, he's our leader on offense. You know, he commanded the team last year. You know, and then for him to come back for his senior year gave us an extra step to be special this year.
Bam! That looks good! That looks good! That looks good! Good
job! You know, it's a lot of things. I don't even think you can count them all, how beneficial it is to be an Arkansas kid. Understand the importance of the program and the fact that friends and family can come watch anytime an hour south. I can head home when I need to head home.
This is his team. There's no doubt about it. He takes the field every day with a passion to be great. You know, he has intensity about him. And he's put in a lot of time in the offseason. You know, we've spent a lot of time in the film room. He's put a lot of time himself. And he's got himself a lot more mentally ready to play the game.
He has learned so much. You know, when he came in from day one, I've talked to some people, and they just said the way he's grown has been just unbelievable. He has grown by leaps and bounds since he first got here, and even in the last year or so. He's gained a lot of confidence, and he was thrust into a leadership role. He stepped in willingly and said, I'm taking this team over. This is my team now. He's handled it remarkably well, and so when you have him to start with, I think you're in a very good spot.
Come on, Tyler. Here we go now. Let's go. Let's go. Let's go. Hit all eight of them. Boom. Good job. Good job. Good job. We know Tyler's the starter. He's the main leader, but that doesn't mean that we don't have four other great leaders in the room. We got that? So make sure we're all doing that. And you can do it even more now that you're playing receiver, too. All right? So I want great leadership out of this room every day.
One question on the team is who will be Wilson's backup. It's a contest between two Brandons, Brandon Mitchell and Brandon Allen.
It's always interesting. You know, we've got a situation that's a little bit unique this year. We have Brandon Mitchell, tremendous athlete, he's got a lot of capabilities, and we're moving him out to receiver a little bit.
You know, it's something me and Tyler came up with first, you know, doing the spring ball. And I was like, man, I just want to get out there on the field. And we was just joking about what other positions I can play. And receiver came up, and, you know, I told him I was okay with it. And we went to Coach Paul and talked to him about it.
Then we have a guy named Brandon Allen who can throw it. In times I'm watching, oh, God, that was a pretty good throw. That's better than I just threw it.
Look. Good.
So, you know, they're going to continue to contribute and fight for that position there. And I think either way we go, we've got a solid situation.
It's a tight race. They're both real good players. Brandon Mitchell is, he's got a good arm. He's accurate. He's probably a little more athletic, can make plays with his feet, can run around, obviously, if we're going to play him receiver. And then Brandon Allen, he's got that, you know, big time arm, chance to play at the next level, accurate, can make all the throws, got a really quick release comp, you know, just he can just make all the throws you want to see.
Brandon Mitchell, there's a young man that it's great to have him in there, but we want to get him on the field, we want to get him taking reps because he is a big, nice body out there that knows how to use his body to shield guys. I just see us getting a lot out of him. So he's not going to be out of the mix, but, you know, we're going to try to really focus on a lot more time and a lot more getting him on the field at wide receiver and letting him play because he's a talent for us. He can make a lot of plays.
Good shot. Here we go.
Catch. I'm throwing it behind you. Go. Right there. Good. Words and blanks every time. Words and blanks.
Running backs coach Tim Horton has never had an arsenal like the one he has this year in the Arkansas backfield.
Hey, good, stay low in my pop, okay? Stay low in your pop.
His three senior leaders, Ronnie Wingo Jr., Dennis Johnson, and Kiero Small, are poised for big seasons. But the focus is on junior running back Niall Davis, who's back after missing all of 2011 with an ankle injury.
Good looking play. Good play.
I remember the play, it was 47. I was taking my zone step. I ran in and I was finna go to the ground. I saw the ground, but my foot was caught behind me and then a guy just fell on it. And then he stayed on it. It was hurting, but it went numb kind of fast, so that was a good thing. But you know, it was just a sad day for me, sad day for my family, and, you know, sad day for Arkansas.
I can remember sitting in a staff meeting trying to decide, are we going to play Niall that day or not? And we made the decision that we were going to treat it like an NFL preseason game for him, in the sense that we'll give him 8 or 10 plays, get him hit 2 or 3 times, get him 3-4 carries, and it didn't work out so well.
I already knew. I knew what I was about to get into as far as rehab and the mental aspect of it and not being able to walk. That's the worst part of her. Your ankle, you can take the shoulder, you can take the collarbone, that's fine, but when you can't walk, can't do stuff for yourself, you know, it was just bad. It's all bad.
You never want to be thankful a guy got hurt, but a little bit, I'm thankful he got hurt. He's back. You know, he's with us this year. He may not have been back. So, you know, look at it. Let's look at it from a positive standpoint. We get him for another year.
And I remember the night he got injured, he and I were the only two in the hospital late that night. And, you know, he was like, hey, coach, I think I can start rehab tomorrow. Hey, let's go get back to work. And that's just the kind of person he is.
I think it made him mentally stronger, in my opinion. I think he's hungrier than ever, you know, missed that whole year. Him coming back now, he's, you know, stronger, faster. So I think it made him better.
Let's go, baby. Turn up on three. 1, 2, 3. Turn up.
The 6 foot, 220-pound Davis is more than ready for a possible record-setting year and a shot at the Heisman Trophy.
Once he got back moving around and things, I saw he was in the meeting room. He was encouraging. He actually helped me a lot last year. So I think, if anything, I don't think it set him back. I think it made him strong and made him work even harder. And you see him out there every day now, he's running like nothing happened.
He's a guy that he wants to be the best at what he does. I think that he's really grown as a leader, you know, and he's done an outstanding job for us, influenced by the way he goes about his business.
The thing that we're so proud about with Niall is he came to the University of Arkansas to graduate, and he's going to do that. And he may not have done that if he hadn't have got injured last year, because he would have probably moved on to the next level.
He's one of the best running backs in the country. Last year was a tough blow for them. You lose him in the preseason, and it took probably a couple weeks for them to really kind of figure out what their plan of action was without him. So with him back, this team's really got a legitimate chance to win the title.
Although Niall Davis is a team captain, his lead blocker commands the same respect. Senior fullback and all-around specialist Kiero Small is a JUCO transfer out of Hartnell Community College in California, who is an integral part of the Razorbacks' game plan on both sides of the ball.
If you ask our players who's the best football player on this team, he would get a whole lot of votes because of his toughness, of his strength level, of his ability to go hit people and play physical football.
He has low pad level. He's only, you know, about 5'2", 5'3", so he's a short guy and he's stocky. So everything he does is powerful. Everything he does is just locomotive. You know, he knows how to just get to a linebacker.
Keep your ass to the quarterback.
He has that personality where people just navigate to him. You know, he's a good guy. And on the field, I don't think I even know anyone tougher.
He has a lot of respect on this football team, and rightly so, because he's earned it by the way he performs in practice and in games.
Compete now, let's compete.
In JUCO, I played mostly linebacker. I've maybe had 5 to 10 snaps a game at fullback. And now I play fullback mostly all the time. I play linebacker a little bit here, but the transition was just getting back into offensive mode. You got a man, you got to beat him to the spot and things of that sort.
Quick. Here we go. 3 turns. 15.
I think he's another guy that the team looks up to automatically because his production on the field and his toughness. You know, when he's broken face masks and broke his face mask, and, you know, when you do things like that, you gain respect very, very quickly. And I think there's not a person on this team he doesn't respect. And when you have that respect, of course, you're a great leader.
He has a nose for the football. You know, playing fullback definitely helps him because he has an understanding of where the backs are trying to fit and things like that. So that all that has just gone into one big ball of him just getting the job done.
I'm 23, so I'm older than a lot of the guys. So the young guys look to me for stuff off the field. How do you handle certain things of that sort. Even with dealing with your rent and then on the field, it's just being tough. That's basically what a fullback got to be. You got to be tough in order to play the position. So I just try to bring toughness and energy to the team.
Coming up on College Football Confidential, Arkansas.
I see this football team as having a confidence in Paul Haynes, a confidence in Tabor Johnson coming in, who are new guys here. So I think they like that.
Hey, let me put you on camera.
I'm always on camera. Nah.
The Razorback defense finished last season ranked 11th in the nation, but their losses to Alabama and LSU by a combined 24 points have left a bitter taste.
And they got a score, right? We held them to a field goal. Sink, let them throw the ball underneath.
You gotta control the seam as a star. All right?
This season, they're determined to improve and have brought in a new defensive coordinator and a new linebackers coach, both from Ohio State, to help in that effort.
Go, see it. Hey, Elton, you're bumped too far. Okay, you should be in the 30, if anything. You're almost in the 40.
Haynes coming in, and that's a little different deal for us. But I think the fit has been great. You know, his relationship with the kids has seemed to have taken off. I mean, and I think they really love him. They love what we're doing. I see this football team as having a confidence in Paul Haynes, a confidence in Tabor Johnson and coming in who are new guys here. So I think they like that.
This ain't high school, is it?
No.
It's better, right?
Yes, sir.
It's better. The best time of your life, I'm telling you.
You know, when you talk from top to bottom, I think the SEC is a little bit more physical a little bit. And I know everybody would sit there and say, well, that's, you know, Big Ten's 3 yards and cloud of dust. But, you know, when you look at guys up front, I always start with the front guys.
You got man to man. Your eyes burn on your man.
You know, where we may have one or two really good players, I think there's five or six, you know, and there's freakish type guys.
There you go! There you go, D! There you go!
So when I look at the personnel, that's what I see the difference, you know, is those guys up front.
There you go. You got to get lower, though. Got to get lower.
I think anytime you play defense, you have to stop the run. That's the number one thing we talked about since we walked through the door. We told and asked our guys to dream about it. When they're eating, think about it. We have to stop the run.
Turn the run! Turn the run! Hustle back. Hey, remember, we're going to put a coverage call on it. 2x2.
We talked about simplifying. We're going to concentrate a lot on tackling. In my opinion, big plays happen a lot of times because of lack of tackling. And when you look at the film last year, you know, there was a lot of missed tackles. So we'll spend a lot of time on that. We'll make sure that the package is simple, sound and simple, that our guys can just fly around and execute.
Because once you do this, guess what? I'm where? I'm close to him. Okay. All you're going to do is just grab me.
This should still be a pretty good run blitz for us now, all right, because these guys are coming off the edge. Now we can fit the flow.
The Arkansas linebacking core is among the best in the nation and has become even stronger with the addition of Tenarius Wright, who moved from defensive end to benefit the team.
To me, there's two types of leaders. There's guys who produce on the field, so of course the team's going to look up to, and then those guys who are the vocal leaders. And Tank was kind of that person that I think a lot of people, our players, looked up to because he was productive on the field. As a player, you know, the sky's the limit. You know, he moved positions, but he hadn't missed a beat. The only thing that he had to work on was his breathing and his heart, because he did a lot more running at linebacker than he did at defensive end. But as far as playing the position, controlling the defense, I mean, the sky's the limit for him.
Tenarius has been a tremendous player for us. At defensive end, obviously a very productive player. So I think his leadership skills have come with his show on the field. You know, we're really happy to have him there, especially right in the middle of our defense.
Fellow linebacker Alonzo Highsmith has also emerged as a leader on the defense. The son of a former Miami Hurricane and NFL running back by the same name, Highsmith led the Razorbacks in tackles for a loss last season.
Alonzo got thrown in the fire last year, but Alonzo would be the first to say that he ain't always know exactly what he was doing. I think now he feels comfortable with knowing what he's doing. You know, he's another guy that has turned up his leadership skills. And he'll probably be the first one, you know, right beside Tank, to get this defense going.
You know, he just makes plays, man. It's in his bloodline from his dad, you know, being in Miami. But, you know, that's something he always jokes about, him being a Florida guy. And, you know, Alonzo, he's just a playmaker, man. He's a playmaker, and another guy lets his play speak louder for him on the field, and he just leads by example.
And Alonzo Highsmith, touchdown, Arkansas.
The lazy days of summer become a distant memory as soon as preseason camp opens in early August. There are no wasted minutes, no wasted motions in the work the Razorbacks do to prepare for the season. For 6 days a week, the team runs through a grinding routine of complex schemes and formations, enduring 100-degree heat. Still, the players must keep their focus, attending 3 position meetings a day, absorbing an endless stream of information. Days can last 17 hours, all devoted to the X's and O's of football.
Y'all know what it is to outwork your opponent. Do we win because we have the most damn talent? We have some talent, but we do what? We grind, we grind, we grind, right?
The word of the program has been and is grind. If we continue to work hard, if we continue to do the right things, if we get into the fourth quarter and we have grind out a win, if we just keep grinding and keep getting stronger with every play and demanding more from one another, that we'll grind it out.
It's definitely a grind, but that's what camp is supposed to be. Our guys realize that. You know, coaches, we realize it. And that's our motto, you know, it's the grind.
The biggest grind is just waking up and just knowing that it's another day to get better. That's just the biggest thing, is overcoming yourself.
You know, I think each day you go out there and by each period, let's get better. Let's walk off that field and have something that we all improved on that day. And go out there and have great effort every day. If you do that, you usually have a chance to improve.
The hardest part, probably mental grind, especially for the younger guys, you know, coming out of high school, and even the guys that's been here for 1 year, you know, you're busy all day until 10:30 at night. Just a mental grind. You have to be physically prepared for it, to get in the ice tug and stuff like that, and then also mentally prepared for every meeting we have.
Quarterback position is different than all the other guys. They're getting beat on every day in practice, and their feet are hurt and their knees are hurt. The offensive line have to wear knee braces every day, so their knees are banged up. Quarterback, we're doing a little bit of everything, so it's different. I mean, yeah, my body's a little bit sore. I got to get the ice tubs, but I got to devote a lot of time to the film room, intense meetings, and I think that's what you got to do to prepare yourself and become a great football player, is push yourself to the ultimate max, and that's what training camp's all about.
Get your pads down. Go! Pad level. Good.
I think the most important thing is we focus on each day. We got to have a good practice today, and before that, we got to have good meetings, and before that, we got to have good preparation as coaches. So I think the most important thing is to just make sure that we take advantage of each segment of the day that we're in, each period that we're in practice, and each practice that we have.
Go, Dylan! Go, Dylan! Go, Dylan! Go, Dylan! Stick and go.
Tempo is number one. We're going to get reps, and in a short amount of time, we won't spend a lot of time running and doing things like that during camp and even into the season. You know, we're going to get in shape for football by playing fast every day.
Good. Go, 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 go. Don't get knocked in. Step on the toes.
The toughest part about this year is it has to be just, you know, being up here all day. I mean, you're up here from 6 o'clock. You have to be mentally prepared to be up all day. If you're not mentally prepared for it, it can break you by the time practice comes.
We feel as though that ain't too many teams putting in this work like how we put it in. Or working as hard on the field and off the field to be great. And that's pretty much how we go about it. I mean, the hours are grind.
Usually by the end of fall camp, the offense and defense are ready to go hit someone else, you know, because you want it that way. They better, you know, everyone better hate to lose. You know, and that's how you become champions. You know, and if that's every rep, if it doesn't bother you to have that guy across from you beat you, then you're in big trouble. You better be very competitive on every rep.
Everybody wants to compete, even with a lot of jobs up for stake right now. You know, you want to be the guy out there making plays. And then with the competition brings, you know, it makes everybody around you better. And it's just been fun, though. It's been fun to see everybody out there competing.
It's okay to have a good fight every now and then, as long as it's not crazy and things like that. And once it's over, you know. It's just like a family, you know. You're around your family every day, all day, and you're going to go at it a little bit. And once it's done, so you need some of that intensity. You know, that's part of the game. You know, we remind them, hey, you can't do anything stupid, nothing that's going to get you a 15-yarder. Let's be smart, let's protect one another. But, you know, that's part of it. We need to have a little bit of that attitude.
All right, keep grinding it out. Let's go. Play hard.
Come on, let's go, man. Let's go, let's go.
And As camp draws to a close, the Arkansas Razorbacks, perhaps as much as any team in the country, are eager for the season to begin. A month of battling and practice after a long offseason of turmoil has brought the team closer together. They can trust in each other while they work toward a common goal, a magical season to silence the critics and erase the controversy.
It's a crucial year for us, and I think the fans expect that. And I know we as a football team and as a staff expect that. It's time to show up, it's time to make a challenge, and it's time to go get a championship. So I think that the fans, the players, the staff don't want to see us going back. They want to see us continuing up the mountain.
Team goals. One is to win an SEC West championship. You got to win your conference in order to get the ultimate goal. And then win the SEC championship. And then win a national championship. You know, that's always our goal. You know, it's not something we always just go around and just say it. It's something that we say it means something.
You can feel it, man. You can Twitter, Facebook, just walking around campus, going to Walmart. You feel that it's going to be a special year just here in Fayetteville. And everybody's anticipating this season because this has never really happened in Arkansas. You know, you got so many high-profile players on one team. A lot of the guys are from Arkansas, you know, which makes Arkansas very proud. And I think if any team has came through here, I think this is a team that can get it done.
I don't know if it's national championship or bust, but it almost has that sort of feel to it this year. I mean, this program has been building and building and building to what it seemed like was going to be this season, you know, with Petrino at the helm. Now, he's not here, but John L. Smith is probably the next best thing because he was part of this all. So I know fans see this program as really being a national title contender this year, and we'll find out what happens.
We coach in the Southeastern Conference. We play in the Southeastern Conference. It's the closest thing in the world that there is to the NFL. We're doing what we do as coaches. We're doing what we do as players. And, you know, we're just trying to improve each day and do what's necessary to win football games.
We want to win a national championship. We want to be in Miami. And we expect that to happen. For us to do that, there are a lot of other special things that will happen. Things that you'll say will define a successful year along the way. But the biggest thing that we're talking about right now is let's make it happen with wins and losses.
Success is measured, in my mind, by your commitment, your work ethic. Do we put everything into what we have? You know, I'm going to measure my success by how hard I worked, how hard I pushed the guys, how hard the guys in the locker room worked behind me. And ultimately, I think that if we do that, and we can say we were successful internally, then externally we'll show.
I think they see this as a year that could be something very special. You know, something magical, almost. Yeah, we've had some problems, but we're not going to let it deter us. I think they've grown from the adversity, and that's what we have to keep pushing them in that direction. And, you know, and that's the way life is, of course. We have to teach them that. This is life. Gentlemen, let's continue on. I mean, we're at a point where there's a very special, window of opportunity out there. And how many times does this opportunity come in your life, something like this? And so I think you can take special pride in that. Okay, we don't care what people think. We're going to make it happen.
People will look at all the SEC teams in the top 10 and say, yeah, they all might be good enough, but they've got to play murderous schedules, all of them. Can they get through it unscathed?
No. And I think Arkansas has the best chance of being in that group to drop out of the top 10 all the way out of the ranking, not because of Arkansas, but because of the schedule. They get LSU and Alabama at home, which is no favor. But then they've got to go on the road to play Auburn, South Carolina, and Mississippi State. Now, it's possible they could lose four of those five games. Now, I don't think it's John L. Smith's fault, who took over for head coach Bobby Petrino after he was fired for indiscretions. I like John L. Smith as a head coach. I think he was the right hire. And I love it that he's emotional. Some people look at his emotion and think that that's a bit over the top and he needs to be a bit more like Nick Saban in his public persona. No, John L. Smith loves life. He loves football. He's not afraid to show you that. I don't think Petrino would be able to get through this schedule unscathed either. And I think, therefore, they have a good opportunity to, or a good chance of being bounced.
You know, one of the big stories in the offseason, injuries and how some players who were hurt last year are coming back this year. And, you know, tonight marks the return of Marcus Lattimore, but he isn't the only player expected to come back. Look at Nile Davis, Ray Graham, Kristen Michael at Texas A&M. A lot of not only star power, but star power from the running back position. Robert, we've seen so many running backs go down with leg injuries. What's the mindset of some of these players now, Lattimore included, having taken, in some cases, an entire year off and now coming back and getting contact?
Well, it could be difficult. And the thing is that you have to trust the science. You have to be able to trust your medical staff or whoever performed that surgery.
The most coveted piece of hardware for an individual in college football, obviously, boys, is the Heisman. And last year, this time of year, we'd have been talking about Trent Richardson, Andrew Luck, maybe Landry Jones at Oklahoma. Robert Griffin III was in that good player, but not a favorite, and he ended up winning it. So if we're looking at a dark horse name right now that could go to New York and take home the Heisman, Todd, give me a name you like.
I like Tyler Wilson, quarterback at Arkansas. You know, it's going to be important that Arkansas wins one of those big home games against either Alabama or LSU, but I think he's the best quarterback in the SEC. Very talented guy. Gets Nile Davis back to take some of the load of that offense.
August in Fayetteville, Arkansas. After an off-season of upheaval, the opening of camp is a relief. The long, hot days of practice with temperatures soaring into the hundreds are predictable. The routine is a comfort.
All we expect is all you got. It's pretty damn simple from there on out. If we think we're the best, we'll be the best. If we think we're champions, we'll be champions.
The Hogs are coming off their best season in 5 years, having finished 2011 with a number 5 ranking and a record of 11-2. Those two losses, both on the road, were to Alabama and LSU, the two contenders in last season's national championship game.
Right now, this team, you guys, we have an opportunity to be special. When that damn door opens, you better be ready to jump through it. You've got a place in time and history right now. Jump through the damn door. Let's go.
By the spring, it was clear that two of the Hogs' most potent weapons would return for 2012. First-team All-SEC quarterback Tyler Wilson chose a shot at college glory over the NFL, and running back Nile Davis had recovered from a season-ending injury suffered a year ago. Head coach Bobby Petrino had all the pieces in place to make a run at the conference crown after returning the Razorback program to prominence.
Arkansas coach Bobby Petrino is at it again. If he's not quitting on his team in the middle of the night via letter, he's running around on his wife with a subordinate half his age, laying his Harley down in the street and then lying about it.
Arkansas could only make one decision.
This afternoon, I informed Coach Petrino that his employment with the university was being terminated immediately.
It was a decision made by the athletic department, which and the athletic director Jeff Long, he had facts that we didn't have.
I think everybody in the world makes mistakes. He's obviously paying for it. He's trying to make everything right, move on with his life. He's my brother. I love him. I'll always be there for him. Always do everything I can. It definitely was it hurt him. It hurt the players. It hurt us.
The night that we were all informed that he was dismissed was it was kind of a weird atmosphere. He comes, Jeff Long walks into the team room, and all the coaches are there, and it's kind of an eerie deal.
I know that when I left that room that day, there was an opportunity for some leaders to step forward and talk about the future, and I thought that was very impressive.
Tenarius Wright was a guy that I think came up huge that night. You know, there's kind of a sense of who's going to take it from here? Who's going to take charge to step up? And Tank said something, everybody sit down.
I kind of wanted to see everyone's face, see what everybody's emotion was, and my emotion came out. It was basically to tell the team that no matter what happens, I'm still willing to put it all on the line, and I expect the same thing from the teammates.
2 weeks ago today, we set out on a search to find a new head coach for the University of Arkansas. Well, it began almost immediately, and then it first began with our own staff looking at our assistant head coach and our two coordinators. But once looking at that situation, none of those individuals had any head coaching experience. And then I began to look outside, look at other coaches who had expressed interest. But it wasn't until an assistant coach through one of my staff members shared that Coach Smith would be interested in helping if he could. And at that point, I was within my process of looking at coaches, and he was someone that I immediately thought, I need to take a look at him.
At this time, it's my honor and my pleasure to formally introduce head football coach of the Arkansas Razorbacks, John L. Smith.
For 40 years, John L. Smith has walked the sidelines of college football. He's held head coaching positions at six different schools, including Louisville and Michigan State, and has earned the reputation as a rebuilder of programs. Smith has also mentored many other coaches along the way, including Bobby Petrino. From 2009 to 2011, Smith served as Petrino's special teams coordinator and outside linebackers coach at Arkansas.
They were poised for an incredible year. And as I looked at it, I thought, what would give them the best opportunity to be successful this season? And then as I examined John L. Smith, he had worked, I think, with eight of the nine coaches on this staff. He knew the student athletes in this team. He knew the mindset of this team. He was a mentor to Coach Petrino, so he understood that whole mindset and that approach to the game of football. It made all the sense in the world, and I think that Coach John L. Smith was the perfect choice for the circumstances we had.
Our expectations are that we're going to go ahead and we're going to battle, and we're going to fight for a national title. Y'all know what it is to outwork your opponent. Do we win because we have the most damn talent? We have some talent, but we do what? We grind, we grind, we grind, right?
Bobby Petrino's younger brother, Paul, knows how to grind. It might seem curious, but Paul Petrino remains with the team. Hired as offensive coordinator after last season, the younger Petrino coaches the quarterbacks.
But what Tyler did a great job of here, everyone, he threw it to the shoulder away from the nearest defender. So make sure we all talk exactly the same when we're helping him. Went on a fade for a touchdown, five-step pitch, outside fade. Don't throw it to him, they're not going to do it in the game. So we cover something in the meeting, throw it to him so he'll do it in the game.
One key piece to Petrino's offense is Tyler Wilson, the only Razorback quarterback to ever be named first team All-SEC. An Arkansas native and lifelong Hogs fan, Wilson's decision to return for his senior year comes as no surprise.
I didn't feel ready to go. You know, there's something deep down inside that says, hey, I've got some unfinished business. I'm an Arkansas guy, I've lived here my whole life. This is comfort to me.
Bam, that looks good, that looks good, that looks good. Good.
You know, that's a lot of things. I don't even think you can count them all, how beneficial it is to be an Arkansas kid. Understand the importance of the program and the fact that friends and family can come watch anytime, an hour south. I can head home when I need to head home.
We know Tyler's the starter, he's the main leader, but that doesn't mean that we don't have four other great leaders in the room. We got that?
Sure.
So make sure we're all doing that. And you can do it even more now that you're playing receiver too. All right, so I want great leadership out of this room every day.
Leadership also comes from running back Niall Davis, who missed all of last year with an ankle injury. But there was reason for him to hurt even more.
When I'm running those stadium steps, I'm thinking about all the things me and my pops went through to get me here and all the things that I have to accomplish in the future.
In the heart of Texas, in a state known for football, Niall Davis grew up with a ball in his hands. The youngest of three children, he was raised by his mother Regina and his stepfather Warren, with whom he trained every day.
Come on!
The summer after leaving eighth grade, you know, he was like,
come on.
You know, what you want to do? And I was like, I want to play sports. I want to play football. You know what I mean? So he was like, let's do it. You know, let's start today. That day we went out to the garage and started lifting weights and, you know, playing around, figuring out a little plan that, you know, how we was going to get there.
Everything that we had was like, it wasn't state of the art. It was like old, you know, the weights were kind of old. It might have a little rust on the side. And it was just straight, you know, sweat and lifting.
In everybody's life, there are people who come along who touch your lives and who have an impact on your life. And I think that, you know, maybe somewhere along the way, Warren struck a chord with Nile, and they developed a really, really good relationship. And I think that, you know, Nile was determined that, hey, you know, I'm going to do this because I don't want to let him down.
After receiving scholarship offers from across the country, Davis chose Arkansas. But when he moved to Fayetteville in January of 2009, it quickly became clear that something was wrong with Warren.
We all came up here, and he saw the facilities and everything, but he would always go back to his room because he said he had a pain in his stomach and his chest.
We drove back, and he went to the doctor. And then that's when they told us he was diagnosed with like stage 4 cancer, like straight out.
Went through the summer, and my mom called me. She was like, "Now you may need to come home." And I was like, "Why?" And she was like, "Warren not doing too well. You know, he's getting worse."
Right about July was the month that the doctors were just saying that we don't think he's gonna make it.
I got to hold his hand while he was dying, and he just left. And it was just silent in the room. The family was there, and it was just different. But it gave me energy, and it gave me a reason to keep going.
Niles inside the 15, inside the 10, the 5, touchdown Arkansas!
And every time I score, I could just think about his smile. You know, he's just smiling at me saying, you know, job well done.
Oh my God, that man would be so proud. You know, I know, I feel that he is with Niles. I know that he is there. But that was their dream. That was their dream, and he just wanted to see his son do something great.
The Michigan fans interested to see how Rich Rodriguez fares at Arizona. Wildcats thinking bowl off a 4-8 season. They open tonight solid favorites over Toledo. It was 41-2 a couple years ago, remember? Rockets got 8 starters back. Oh, Kansas, Charlie Weiss. Dane Crist, a fellow Domer, trying to spark a bad offense. The defense was dead last year ago. The Jackrabbits of South Dakota State, they can score. John L. Smith, much higher expectations, coaching to extend his contract. 2 cupcakes for the Crimson Tide come calling week 3. Paul Crist and Pitt versus Youngstown State, an FCS team. Panthers, 4th coach in 3 years. They're thinking BCS in the farewell year in the Big East. And, of course, the most scrutinized, anticipated rookie debut in years. 2 hours away, Bill O'Brien launches the post-Paterno era on your alma mater, Arkansas, hosting Alabama in a couple weeks. Real quick, can the Hogs pull the upset?
Well, now that's big. I was going to talk about today's Arkansas.
Okay, No.
But candidly, they do have a situation where they can rise to the occasion, and they're going to be in a perfect setting in the hills of Arkansas. And, yeah, they've got talent. They've got players that can compete with this Alabama team, in my mind.
The toss and elected to receive. They'll start far first on offense tonight, and Dennis Johnson will go back into the end zone as the lone return man to get ready to field the kickoff from Jacksonville State. Griffin Thomas will kick it away.
Dennis Johnson on track to become the SEC's all-time kickoff return in terms of yardage leader. Averaged 6.3 yards per carry last year out of that backfield.
serious threat. And the first kickoff of 2012 will be returned. Dennis Johnson from inside his five, and he barely crosses the 15-yard line.
Arkansas times. Out of the eye, and Gregg is in motion, and the give is to Nile Davis. A nice move to avoid the block, the tackle in the backfield, and he'll have the first down. Caleb Lawrence, a walk-on for Jacksonville State, brings him down, but not before he gets to the 32-yard line. And the Razorbacks move the chains on their first offensive series.
I think Arkansas feels good about their starting five on that offensive line. Maybe the depth is still a little bit of a question mark. We were told he might be splitting out at wide receiver a little more often this year. Play fake that time to Wingo. Wilson to throw, hit as he throws, but the wobbler is still brought down by Gregg into Jacksonville State territory at the 45, and inside the 40, he goes to the 37.
And Scott, all set up by Arkansas's ability to run the ball effectively the first couple of times they've tried it. Chris Gregg has terrific straight line speed. And when he's running from one side of the field to the other, Wilson lays it right on the numbers in stride.
A 26-yard gain, and now Davis around the right end inside the 30, and he's knocked out of bounds. Clipped there by the Jacksonville State defender, Rashawn Byers. Washawn Ely in the backfield, and off the left tackle, he'll get about 3 yards. It's a pro-style offense, but they will run some option. And here we go. Ivory met and dropped. Chris Smith met him at about the line of scrimmage. Field goal attempts coming up by Griffin Thomas, and it's blocked. It'll be a touchback. And Byron Jones looked like he was the guy who might have gotten a hand on it. Let's take a look. 54, Byron Jones blocks the field goal. Arkansas football. After an unsuccessful trip, a turnover on their first drive. Play fake. Wilson to throw. He has Kobe Hamilton. Hamilton with a nice move. Another nice move. And he will get to the 29-yard line.
They're everyday guys. Win a lot of football games with everyday guys.
Wilson to throw on first and 15. The ball is caught inside Jacksonville State territory. Third down early in the ballgame. Out of the shotgun. Here's Wilson. Over the middle. Caught by Gregg. And Gregg will drag a defender inside the 20. And he's still going. Finally rolled down at the 14 of the Gamecocks.
He may be as big an offensive weapon that Arkansas has to put on the field this year. You have to always account for the tight end when Chris Gregg is on the field. The guy's 6'5", and I talked about his straight-ahead speed.
A 33-yard gain. First and 10 in the red zone, and Davis around the end gets inside the 5. He leveled a defender, Ben Endress, and then Brenton Tolson brought him down. It'll be first.
And they did not do it on that play.
This time they'll give it to the second man through, and it is a touchdown, Arkansas. Cody Walker with the carry. The redshirt freshman from Jeff City, Missouri, in his first action after sitting out last year with injury. Jack Crow calls Ivory a coach in training. The handoff goes to Sean Ely, and he's got nowhere to go. Byron Jones brings him down almost immediately. Stacked receivers, four of them on the left side on first and goal from the 9. And the pass is tipped away. Great job by Ross Rasner to sniff out that play. And he almost, another half step, Jimmy, and he had a touchdown.
Absolutely. And again, this is a new look from Jacksonville State in this football game early. Rasner reads it well, shoots the gap,
and he gets the handoff. Looking for room on the outside. Cuts it up. Lowers his shoulder pad and gets close to first down yardage. A good run by Rashad Smith. The first 15 in the books at Reynolds Razorback Stadium. And we're all tied up. Dennis Johnson back to return the kick of Jacksonville State. This one will sail into the end zone. And Dennis Johnson's going to bring it out from 6 or 7 yards deep. And he breaks two tackles. And he's out of bounds at the 41-yard line. Well, I tell you, we heard John L. Smith and some of the other coaches.
Well, again, before this last series, Paul Petrino said, it's time to pick up the intensity. Make a play or go home. And that's exactly what you saw Dennis Johnson do on this kickoff return. He was 5 yards deep, and he told him, let's go. We got to make a play. Now they have a fire lit up under him.
All right, Michael, thank you very much. Quick throw over the middle. It is caught by Javonte Herndon. He breaks three for a first down and more into Jacksonville State territory. Johnson back there blocking, and Wilson's going up top. Wide open, Chris Gregg. Touchdown, Arkansas. Arkansas ties the game at 14, and they only needed a minute 47 to do it. That quick strike offense on display on that touchdown, Jimmy.
Well, Jacksonville State wasn't ready to play. Rashad Smith, number 51, the linebacker for the Gamecocks, right there in the middle of your screen as you just watch this thing getting ready to roll. He's the middle linebacker, and he's right there in the middle of the field. His assignment is Chris Gregg. Now watch what happens. Roll tape. Now 51 realizes, where's my guy?
Too late.
It's a too late. It's a foot race. Smith back for a 10-month contract, and we shall see.
Catch made by Gregg at the 45-yard line. And Wilson with good protection, and he finds Davis out of the backfield. He's got the first down inside the 20-yard line. Goes Nia Davis, James Powell. Herndon stays in there. He's split wide to the left. Nile Davis in the backfield. Play fake. Rollout. Wilson. End zone. Touchdown, Arkansas. Chris Gregg again. All right. Second down and a long eight. The option play with Blanchard. He'll be chased down from behind by Chris Smith. Ivory on third down and seven. Has some time, then he's knocked down, and he'll throw it away at the last minute. He was very fortunate there not to go down with a sack. Chris Smith again back there in the backfield along with Alonzo Highsmith. It's got back-to-back three and outs now for Arkansas's defense. You don't have to do much else. Another huge hole, and Johnson has the first down inside the 35 all the way down to the 31. Pierre Warren, an all-conference caliber safety. Gamecocks coming on the blitz. Wilson hangs in there and hangs it up for Brandon Mitchell, who makes a great catch, and it's first and goal.
Take a shot and come up limping and slow, getting back to the huddle. And the very next play, bam, comes back and delivers a strike.
What a catch, yeah, by Brandon Mitchell. 34-yard gain. First down and goal from the JSU 3. The give is to Wingo, and Wingo is into the end zone. Touchdown, Arkansas.
Know as a coach, what are my guys doing on the sidelines when we have to make an adjustment within the game? That's something you only find out in that first game.
Ivory with the handoff to Pope, and Pope barely had time to take the handoff. Wilson back in to run the show from the 46, all day to throw, and a shot on the money up the seam to Brandon Mitchell, and Mitchell wrestled down at the 15-yard line. You won't see a better throw than that.
I actually tweeted before the ball game. You can follow me at Jimmy Dykes Live. Name a better combo in the country than Nile Davis and Tyler Wilson in terms of a quarterback and a running back. And I can't come up with
one. I haven't seen any better. No.
Nope.
First and goal, and here's Wilson handing off to Davis again. Bang. Davis finds the end zone. Touchdown, Arkansas.
I think Nile Davis's vision has been really good so far in this football game. He's got his eyes up and executing it to perfection.
Blanchard on the keeper, and he is leveled. Arkansas's offense, everything you expected and more, but the defense has allowed three touchdowns, including a late second quarter strike. He's going to run the option, and he gets nailed as he pitches. And so the pitch went wild. Pope had nothing to do but eat it. Third down and five. Wilson over the middle to Gregg. And Gregg has a first down over the 40. I'm sorry, Brandon Mitchell over the 40-yard line at the 41. Wilson, good time this time. And he's got a man wide open. It's Herndon. And Herndon will score. Touchdown, Arkansas, 63 yards. Thank you.
Scott, you can't give Tyler Wilson that much time. That's a three-step drop, stands, looks, bam. And Herndon just angles towards the goalpost. Well thrown, and Arkansas's quick strike ability is on display in this stadium. Extra point is good. And the Razorbacks stretch the lead to 42-24. Is the guy listed, and he has been punting tonight, but they brought in a new punter, fielded at the 50 by Holmes, and he was not brought down. There is no whistle, and Holmes is in the outside. The 20, 15, 10, 5. Touchdown, Arkansas. 50-yard return by Holmes. No whistle. It will stand unless they have a review, but everybody on the football field stopped. Holmes kept going. Scott, I talked about this kid's speed in the first half. And again, the end-around play, and the ball pops loose, and it's picked up by Arkansas. Alonzo Highsmith on the recovery, and the Razorbacks get it right back. And Scott, I think it was Chris Smith that really brought a lick at the end of this play to pop that ball loose. Right, bam, there. Can't tell for sure who it was. Wilson from the gun on second down and 10. Over the middle again, caught by Mitchell. A nice grab, shakes a tackle, and he's loose. The 20, the 15, knocked out of bounds inside the 10-yard line. Brandon Mitchell with a nice grab and run, 40 yards. Pierre Warren knocked him out. And the Razorbacks have a first and goal just inside the Gamecock 10. Dennis Johnson on the run, and Dennis Johnson can walk into the end zone. Touchdown, Arkansas. 9 yards. Secondary.
Yeah, who's wearing who down now? Yeah. Jacksonville State says, okay, it's our turn for offensive line to
Pope again, and this time Trey Flowers is there to stop him in his tracks. It'll be a loss of about two for this offense, and it's a draw play to James. He's met at the line of scrimmage and turned away. Hey. 10th ranked Arkansas on top big in their season opener. Play clock still with 10 seconds as Ivory gets the snap and goes down under heavy pressure. Chris Smith drives him back to the 33-yard line.
For Chris Smith, like he was shot out of a cannon. Coming from the right side of your screen. Boom. Takes a good angle because a couple of times Arkansas's defensive end, Flowers in particular, got too much of the inside line to Ivory to get outside, but not. He's got a big-time arm.
Stands in the pocket there and delivers a strike to Chris Gregg, and Gregg fights his way off of tacklers and gets it.
Jacksonville State in this game.
Ivory on the give to Pope, and Pope is hit at the line of scrimmage and dropped almost immediately by Robert Thomas.
As well they should. The guy's too good. Averaged over 6 yards a carry last year.
Off and running. Look at this. Brandon Allen on a quarterback scramble. Goes for 27 yards.
Scotty's a good athlete. I saw him make plays like this in high school, at Fayetteville High School, just making something out of nothing. Everybody's covered up. A good cutback gets the ball out, got away from his body a little bit right there, but then he does a good job of tucking it back in once the contact's going to come.
And he gets the call. Turns the corner on the right side and gets close to first down yardage, breaking the play to the 20.
A lot of positives in the football game for Arkansas, absolutely. But a lot of question marks as well.
Blanchard fumbles the football, and Arkansas recovers at the 30-yard line. A successful opening night. The Razorbacks a 25-point victor over Jacksonville State.